although most of his time was spent prior to this in the intelligence agencies, as well as in the US military. Let me just say that I think Sid's academic work is also worth praising. I mean, people always talk about policy, but his academic work is quite good. I'm actually reading a forthcoming book about Kim Il-sung, where his book on Kim Il-sung has been cited quite often. I noticed it was cited by this author much more than my book was cited, but I'm not counting citations or anything like that. So, and then finally, I would like to say that this is one of our Korea platform series in the Korea Chair, and we are grateful to Samsung Electronics America for their support of the Korea platform at the Korea Chair. So Sid, I will give the floor to you. You may use the podium to make some remarks. And thank you again for joining us.
Well, thank you, Victor, for that kind introduction. You know, it's an honor to be speaking here today on this particular issue of unification. I know it's an issue that for our Republic of Korea friends here, you've grown up your whole lives thinking about virtually. And for those who are not Korean, who come here via Korean studies, U.S. government work, academic work, journalism, from the very, you know, time you encounter the Korea issue, unification of the Korea Peninsula is something we've all given thought through. Personally, having followed this and studied it for a few decades myself, I'm really glad to see that the discussion is moving beyond the abstract and the theoretical various formulae for unification that, when you look back on them, had very little to do with the geopolitical or security realities at the time. Instead, we're in the realm of the concrete, the real, moving to concrete conceptualization and planning for a reality we all know is coming. It's also encouraging to see the shift in the discussion of the economic dimensions of unification, which I know you just covered. The idea that unification need not be feared simply because of some unverifiable and alarmist forecast of potential cost is certainly not a new one. But in this regard, the bold vision and leadership of President Park in declaring that unification is a bonanza or a windfall or a taebak, to keep it easy in the Korean, and that it might bring a bonanza to Korea and the region is certainly an long overdue and encouraging proclamation and a reframing of the unification discussion. Finally, one other encouraging development related to this issue is that there are a few people out there today that question the commitment of the United States to a unified Korean peninsula. There may have been a time when many Koreans thought that the U.S. may have saw some advantage in a divided Korea peninsula, but that's certainly not the case any longer. Our Korean friends realize that unification is indeed a central tenet of our overall Korea policy, and that's what I'd like to speak to today. By providing a holistic, if brief, overview of our broader Korea Peninsula and regional policy goals, I think we can see how the interaction of our various lines of effort on our current approach to the North Korea issue all come together, and how all this, by extension, therefore, ties to the issue of reunification. So let me start with a broad but brief regional context. In his August 13th East-West Center speech on the United States Vision for Asia-Pacific Agreement in Hawaii, Secretary Kerry described how America's security and prosperity are closely and increasingly linked to the Asia-Pacific. An Asia marked by democratic governance, free markets, a rules-based security order, and a respect for human rights is in everybody's interest. First and foremost, for those who make the Asia-Pacific their home, and certainly to the United States, which has been and always will be a Pacific nation. It's natural, therefore, that the United States seeks a stable and economically vibrant Asia and is actively involved throughout the region toward that end. And of course, it should come as no surprise then that these broader goals are the very foundation for our Korea policy as well. You know, as we watch these goals materialize in the Republic of Korea, a vibrant free market democracy, we never lost sight, of the fact that our ultimate goal is of a unified Korea, where all 70 million or so Koreans can enjoy democracy, free markets, a respect for human rights, and dignity. Our efforts in this regard were never designed to stop at the 38th parallel, and nor are they today. In the broadest sense, we see a unified Korea with these goals, democracy, free market economy, prosperity, respect for human rights and dignity, as the natural end state toward which the Korean people, we, and in fact history itself, are heading. That's why the president in comments alongside President Park in April of this year stated that the United States, and this is a quote, the United States supports the Korean people's desire for unification, and I, the president, share President Park's vision of a unified Korea that's free from the fear of war, free from nuclear weapons, and where people throughout the peninsula enjoy the political and economic freedoms that exist here, speaking from Seoul, in the South. And as President Park's own Dresden speech made clear, there are plans, strategies, and actions that we must devise and implement today that lay the foundation for and create the conditions conducive to a peaceful path toward those ends. Actions we take today that lead toward a democratic Korean peninsula where everybody can enjoy political freedom and have a voice in their future. Actions we can take today that lead to a Korean peninsula with a vibrant economy, where the prosperity enjoyed by people throughout the peninsula contributes to regional and global economic growth and prosperity. Actions we can take today that contribute to a peaceful Korea unification, free from weapons of mass destruction, a peaceful Korea peninsula free from weapons of mass destruction, benefiting regional and global security as well. And then finally, actions we can take today that can lead toward a Korea free of gulags, free of repression, and free of the other cruelties that the UN Commission of Inquiry so well documented. Is this ambitious? Yes. Is it too much to handle, particularly given the importance of denuclearization and stability? I don't think so. Secretary Kerry, in his speech in Hawaii, noted that our efforts to denuclearize North Korea and deter and defend against the nuclear missile threat are important. And he also emphasized our commitment to speak out against the horrific human rights situation in the North. In doing so, the Secretary made clear that denuclearization and improved human rights are not mutually exclusive, contradictory policy objectives. As the leadership of North Korea begins to make the right strategic choices that can bring the peace and prosperity its people deserve, we will see progress on denuclearization. We will see progress on human rights. We will see economic growth and a better standard of living for the North Korea people. The same type of peace and prosperity that we see marks the rest of the region. Again, too difficult, impossible, contrary to the facts on the ground, contrary to the lessons of the last 70 years almost. No, I don't think so at all. I mean, look at the example of Burma. The example of Burma stands proof of what can happen, a transformation that unfolded thanks to a broad strategic decision by its leadership that then translated into a transformation of Burma's relations with the outside world. A transformation that unfolded with the international community, with the United States in the lead, with the international community ready to encourage and enable the changes on the ground that we've seen there. Transformation driven by a pragmatic and clear-eyed recognition that democratic and free market societies flourish while authoritarian repressive regimes wither. A transformation that does remain a work in progress, a work in process, but that shows the potential for a nation when its leadership makes the right decisions to move down a fundamentally different path that may have seemed beforehand unimaginable, impossible, too hard, too difficult. And as the United States has demonstrated by the speed and agility with which it responded diplomatically to these developments in Burma, the same option is available to the leadership of the DPRK. But until that day comes, How do we today move to that future we've identified as our goal? How do we translate this aspirational into practical policy objectives and goals? This is a good segue into a brief discussion of our current North Korea policy. North Korea, the United States remains committed to a peaceful denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula through authentic and credible negotiations. Let me emphasize again, we want to resolve denuclearization via negotiations. We're not ideologically opposed to dialogue with North Korea, nor have we placed insurmountable obstacles to negotiations in our insisting that North Korea simply demonstrate a willingness to live up to its international obligations and abide by international norms of behavior. The bar has not been set too high by insisting that denuclearization talks be about denuclearization and that they would progress along the lines of the September 19, 2005 joint statement of the six-party talks. Now, of course, talks are not an end unto themselves. They are a means to an end. Talks must lead to a stated purpose, in this case denuclearization, in order to be authentic. Talks must demonstrate a possibility for concrete actions, for concrete progress, to be credible. And even as we pursue a path to authentic and credible talks, leading to complete, verifiable, and irreversible denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, our broader policy goes beyond talks, goes beyond just dialogue, and integrates three major lines of effort: diplomacy, pressure, and deterrence, which I would like to speak to today. Because together, these three lines of effort, diplomacy, pressure, and deterrence, seek to roll back the North Korean nuclear program while countering, deterring, and defending against the threat. Let me start with the latter, deterrence. I see some representatives of the Republic of Korea military here, active, duty, and retired, who have spent their careers working in the defense of the Republic of Korea. It's good to see you here, General Chung, General Shin. And they will tell you our alliance remains strong. Our U.S. and ROK forces go together on a daily basis, and our counter-provocation planning ensures that Pyongyang clearly knows that as it contemplates its next set of provocations or its next actions, it faces a rock-solid U.S.-ROK alliance. In response to the North's pursuit of nuclear and missile capabilities, our counter-missile planning, our tailored extended deterrence, stand as concrete examples of our shared commitment to denying North Korean ability to threaten and intimidate the Republic of Korea through its pursuit of these capabilities. And in the face of outlandish rhetorical threats and posturing, our firm yet calm responses coupled with our seamless and transparent US-ROK cooperation remain the foundation of our success in denying North Korea the benefits of its provocative behavior and attempts at coercive diplomacy. Deterrence is working. Security is ensured. On pressure, it's important to know our sanctions are not designed to hurt the North Korean people. They are designed instead for a number of purposes that contribute to peace and stability on the peninsula. Our sanctions are a key element of our efforts to constrain the growth of the North's WMD program, to curtail its proliferation activities worldwide. And by impeding the exports and repatriation of profits from illicit sales abroad, we're able to deny North Korea the resources it needs to sustain and advance its nuclear and missile programs. By inflicting an economic and diplomatic cost for behavior that clearly runs counter to international norms and DPRK's own international obligations, we also sharpen the DPRK's choices and lead the leadership in Pyongyang to make better choices that will benefit its country and its people. We also make clear that Pyongyang's aspirations for improving its economy and improving the livelihood of its people are fundamentally inconsistent with its pursuit of nuclear weapons. Thereby, moving forward, we will continue to seek robust implementation of UN Security Council resolutions and U.S. sanctions on North Korea. If the DPRK makes the right choice, returns to the negotiating table, and embarks on a credible path of irreversible denuclearization, and begins to come into compliance with its international obligations and commitments, the appropriateness of these sanctions would, of course, be reviewed. But with our ultimate goal being denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula through peaceful means, we continue to believe that a dual-track approach, dialogue as possible, pressure as necessary, is the best path to authentic and credible negotiations. Which brings us to the role of diplomacy. And the question that I'm sure many of you have, how do we get DPRK, how do we get North Korea back on the denuclearization path? First, let me say that we believe the six-party talks framework has provided and continues to provide a useful platform for diplomacy. It has, over the past several years, helped us bring a consensus to the need for North Korea to return to a credible path of denuclearization, and we'll continue to use this framework moving forward. We've built a strong international consensus on the need for North Korea to denuclearize. We strengthened cooperation with the other four parties within that framework. And most importantly, we've maintained five-party commitment and consensus on the September 19, 2005 joint statement as the bedrock framework for a path toward denuclearization that in return would bring a range of diplomatic, economic, and security benefits to the DPRK. With the September 19th statement, there is remarkable clarity to the expectations of the DPRK in terms of denuclearization and the potential benefits to Pyongyang should it choose this path. And of course, the United States for the past 5 years has demonstrated a willingness to engage North Korea. We did so with Ambassador Bosworth's trip to Pyongyang in December 2009. After the events earlier that year of a Taepodong launch and a nuclear test, with a process that began in 2011 after the Cheonanam and the Yeonpyeong shelling, with a process that led to the February 29, 2012 understanding, which was shortly thereafter walked away from by the North, and of course with our contacts through the New York Channel. Our policy is not one of not talking for the sake of not talking, if you can handle the triple negative. We have been and will continue to be willing to engage Pyongyang. Engage Pyongyang to probe its intentions, to push and urge it to make the right decision by presenting to the leadership an alternative path, and to prove our sincere commitment to improve US-DPRK relations once North Korea begins to move down the path of denuclearization. But clearly the ball is in Pyongyang's court. So of course, one can see how this three-pillared approach, deterrence, pressure, diplomacy, also contributes to creating the types of conditions favorable to the future we all envision and we're all talking about here today, a unified Korea Peninsula that's free of war, free of nuclear weapons, and just plain free. We engage in diplomacy to seek a breakthrough on denuclearization and to ensure that the international community speaks with one voice and that Pyongyang hears one voice, telling Pyongyang that the peace, security, and prosperity it seeks remain possible, but only once the leadership makes the decision to move down the path of denuclearization. We can use pressure as needed to constrain those aspects of North Korea behavior that are destabilizing and detrimental to our goal of laying the groundwork for peace, prosperity, and security that enables unification down the road. And then finally, until we get to that day, we will seek to ensure a safe Korean Peninsula through deterrence, looking for the day when the threat posed on the peninsula no longer exists. We will speak out on the human rights issue as we look toward the day when Koreans throughout the peninsula enjoy the same political and economic freedoms now enjoyed in the Republic of Korea, to the day when human rights are guaranteed, to the day when political prison camps are emptied. And we stand ready, as President Park also has made quite clear, we stand ready to engage with a denuclearizing North Korea to help its leadership move the country down a different path in which ultimately a transformed DPRK can begin to join in and enjoy the dynamic prosperity that marks the rest of the region. The conversations you're having here today look forward to a process we all hope a unification process we all hope will unfold in the not-too-distant future. The mere fact that we are here today reflects our shared understanding, and by our, I mean including that of U.S. official policy, our shared understanding that planning for this day, as you're doing here today, is a task that we can not put off. We simply cannot afford to wait. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Sid, for a very helpful statement of what our policy is and what U.S. aspirations are for the peninsula. Dr. Seiler has time for a couple of questions before he has to go back to work in his new office. please, we'll open the floor to a couple of questions, and then please identify yourself and be brief and ask a question. Okay. Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Mitch Michniowski, and I'm a student at the Elliott School. we talk that the leadership in Pyongyang is irrational and that it does things that are counter to its interests, but what I think we could all agree on is that Pyongyang works to protect itself. In the 1990s, the country of Ukraine gave up its nuclear weapons for a security agreement with Russia and the United States to protect it in the event of an attack. Since then, one of them has attacked Ukraine and the other one has failed to protect it. Given that, do you think that North Korea, in protecting its own interest, has any intention or can see any credibility in an agreement from the U.S. or, by that extent, the six-party talks? Thank you very much.
Well, that's an excellent question, but I think it's one, really, that you would have to ask the leadership of Pyongyang. But let me say that, you know, the framework of the six-party talks approach to denuclearization and why we have sought for the past several years, going back to the previous administration, to pursue a multilateral approach is because the type of environment in which North Korea could move forward confident of its sovereignty is respected, its interests are reflected, that nobody teams up or bullies it, is found in the six-party talks process. You have the major surrounding powers, all the relevant parties there at the table. It provides, aside from the question of security guarantees and what might be generated through the process, the very process itself provides an environment that I believe and we believe is conducive to North Korea moving down the path of denuclearization without having fears for its security along the lines of the example you provided.
Dr. Green, bring a mic up to the front.
So thank you for coming and congratulations on your new job, and you're the right man for the job, and I don't know what you did wrong to get it, but because it's going to be hard, but I think all of us who follow this issue have great confidence in the fact you're there and the presentation you gave. It was a good speech, and I agree with all of it. The only thing I would say is Victor Char or Michael Green could have given that speech in 2006 in the Bush administration, and since then things have happened, nuclear tests and a North Korean change to the Constitution and declaration that they are a nuclear weapon state. So how is the administration explaining that piece of it? We want to get back on the path of denuclearization, six-party talks to the right framework, but what do we do about the cheating and proliferation that has occurred since the six-party talks were last meeting?
Michael, that's an excellent question. This is why I put this emphasis on the three pillars, because they're mutually complementary. They take into concerns the realities of the difficulties we're facing in terms of getting authentic and credible negotiations restarted at this time. Take advantage of the international consensus in terms of an unacceptability of a nuclear in North Korea and the threat posed by proliferation to build the type of international cooperation necessary to strengthen a counter-proliferation regime, to limit. It's not perfect. It's not a a loophole-free system out there, but to limit North Korea's ability to benefit from its illicit activities abroad, its proliferation activities, reduce its benefits. And also, in terms of taking the actions necessary in terms of our military posture, our military training, our missile defense capabilities, so that we counter the threat to whatever degree it's developed. So it's prophylactic in terms of trying to counter the threat that's emerged. And so we will continue to try to seek a negotiated settlement to this issue. We will continue to apply the pressure necessary so that the leadership in Pyongyang realizes that its true security and prosperity will only come when it walks away from, not when it holds on to these capabilities. And in the meantime, take the actions necessary for the defense of the United States, the defense of the Republic of Korea, the defense of Japan, and defense of others, many who are threatened by these capabilities as they develop.
Right. I'm gonna have to close the floor. I'm sorry, but let me just ask you one question before I do, as in the prerogative of the chair. So as you know, Sid, the news story today about North Korea, about these three Americans that are detained there. Can you tell us what the U.S. administration is doing to get these folks out, and whether the prospects of that are very likely at this moment?
Well, it goes without saying, but it's worth repeating that, the top priority of the United States government is the safety of our citizens abroad, and it's we have three cases there that have been ongoing for some time. We have worked to secure the release of all three through New York Channel, through the Swedes, and I think you would appreciate, and I think everybody here would appreciate that the sensitive details of our negotiations and our efforts aren't really going to be played out through this room, but these three cases have posed a significant obstacle to an improvement of US-DPRK relations, and we hope that North Korea would act in a humane and right way in helping us resolve these in the near future.
Right. Well, I think on behalf of everyone here, we want to thank you for joining us today, allowing us to be part of your coming out party.
Mm-hmm.
And we know you have to get back to work, so thanks very much. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Please be seated. Please be seated. Next session will start soon.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to begin the third panel. So we're shifting from the morning discussion, which was a focus on the economic, business, and investment synergies in a unification scenario, now to the politics and the security issues related to unification. Again, looking at both the cautionary notes, but as well as the optimistic ones when we think about a unification of the Korean Peninsula. I guess for three of you this morning, you know, the theme that's been going through, and it started with Ambassador Ahn's talk, was he kept referring to everybody on these panels as the so-called dream team, using the basketball analogy. And so,
because you dream of getting someone else instead of us.
Could be. But I do think we do. I do think we have a dream team for this particular panel on the Northeast Asian perspective. Our first presenter is Dr. Michael Green, who is the Senior Vice President for Asia and Japan Chair at the CSIS. He is also an Associate Professor of International Relations and Asian Studies at the Wall School of Foreign Service at Georgetown. And as many of you know, he served in the Bush administration as Senior Director for Asian Affairs on the National Security Council. Speaking after him will be Dr. Park Geun-hye of Ihn-Hwi Women's University. He is a professor in the Division of International Studies at Ihn-Hwi University, has an expertise that is quite broad, ranging across U.S. foreign policy, Northeast Asian issues. He's currently on the advisory committee for the Ministry of Unification and received his PhD in international politics from Northwestern. And then we have two discussants on the panel. The first is Mr. Christopher Johnson, who is the senior advisor and holds the Freeman Chair in China Studies here at CSIS. Chris is one of the foremost, was within the U.S. government, one of the foremost experts on China policy with a long and distinguished career in the CIA. And I know that I and Mike and others were very happy that he came out of government to join us here at CSIS. So welcome, Chris. And then batting cleanup, if we're continuing with the sports analogies, is Bruce Klinger, who is at the Heritage Foundation. He's a senior research fellow there in the Asian Studies Center. And he, too, comes from a very long and distinguished career working in the intelligence agencies, both at the Central Intelligence Agency as well as the Defense Intelligence Agency, and he was the CIA's Deputy Division Chief for Korea. So we will begin with our two presenters. We'll start with Mike. Please feel free to use the podium.
Thank you, Victor. I'm mic'd, so I don't need this, but I have a cough, so if you hear the sound of artillery, that's my microphone going off. This is an important topic. Unification of the Korean Peninsula could end the suffering of 25 million North Koreans, an unpredictable threat not only to Northeast Asia but to the entire world, and could produce ultimately a peace jackpot, not just the economic potential jackpot that was discussed this morning. But when powers collapse, and in my view, and perhaps I'm not consistent with the other speakers, but in my view, real unification happens only when North Korea has collapsed. And when powers collapse, you can't always predict the changes. In the Second World War, the collapse of the Axis power in Europe and in Asia freed tens of millions of people, ended the war, but left a vacuum in Manchuria, the Korean Peninsula, Southeast Asia, Central and Eastern Europe that created the new tensions and new suffering in the Cold War. And then the collapse of the Soviet Union at the end of the Cold War brought freedom to tens of millions of peoples in Eastern and Central Europe, but opened up historic wounds in places like Yugoslavia and, as we see today, Ukraine. So the question for Korean unification is whether the unification will open new patterns of cooperation in Northeast Asia based on 21st century norms, or reawaken 19th and 18th century patterns of rivalry and competition that have been so tragic for Northeast Asia and particularly for the Korean Peninsula. And on the whole, I'm optimistic that the former scenario will be the one we see. I think ultimately the mutual interests among the major powers in Northeast Asia will align. But there are a lot of reasons to worry that they might not, and to avoid complacency and think now not only about the economic aspects of unification, but what will the national security and geopolitical requirements be. I'm going to go through the major powers briefly. I think Chris will certainly add more detail on China, and Bruce will as commentators. China. I've spent about 20 years in and out of government talking to Japanese, Korean, Chinese, Russian counterparts about what unification would look like. And in some cases, you have official statements. In China's case, Wang Yi, the foreign minister, said in March that China supports denuclearization, but China's red line is no war, no instability. I think, and Chris should comment on this, that while the Xi Jinping government has openly displayed its disdain for Kim Jong-un, it has, in effect, doubled down on stability in the North in terms of investment and support. Xi Jinping has said, reportedly to President Park, that he supports unification. But in my discussion with Chinese government officials and scholars, there's an important caveat, which is quote unquote independent unification, which means when you burrow in, no outside powers, particularly the US, driving it, and it has to be mutual. North Korea, in effect, gets a vote. And I've had Chinese counterparts argue that if there is unification, there would someday have to be a way to represent the views of the 25 million people in North Korea. To which I ask, you mean a national referendum? And then my Chinese counterparts change the subject. I think it's less about the North Korean people and more about preserving, as long as possible, a structure and institutions in the North that are more favorable to China's interests. China clearly is concerned about instability, about refugees, and about the implications of a unified Korean peninsula that is democratic and aligned with the US and by implication, therefore, Japan. Not only because of the geostrategy of it, but because of the demonstration effect of democratization and the impact that might have on views in Taiwan or elsewhere within China. There's, I think, a very robust debate within China. The best evidence was the famous Financial Times article by Deng Yuan of the Central Party School's China or Study Times, suggesting China should abandon North Korea, that regime collapse was better. He was, of course, sacked. But I still think within the Chinese system there is a robust debate. It's just not as public as it was a year or two ago. My belief is that Beijing ultimately sees a delay in unification as being in China's interests because of the concerns about instability and because of an assumption that time is on China's side, that trade patterns with both North and South Korea are moving in a way that China will have, in effect, a casting vote or a decisive vote. The longer this takes, the more economic interdependence there is from both Koreas on China. I think that's the Chinese assumption as they look at this. I also think that the Chinese government, the PLA, worry about some of the consequences of unification. There's evidence that the PLA has prepared for consequence management of chemical or other incidents along the border. That in 2009, the migration of 50,000 armed Kokang militiamen from northern Burma into China was a test case for disarming and returning them that PLA officers and officials look at as a trial run for a much larger case if North Korea collapses. So the Chinese are not putting their heads in the sand on this question, in my view. But they want to wait. They want it to be, quote unquote, independent. And I believe we'll do whatever is possible to preserve institutions in North Korea, even if the Kim Jong-un regime goes. So for Korea, what this means is that rapprochement with Beijing and President Park's relationship with Xi Jinping are a good thing, but I think the ROK has to think carefully about how it is framing Chinese expectations and Chinese leverage over this process, and how successfully Seoul is indicating its red line and its bottom line for unification. Japan, I started this business as a Japan guy, and I think today strategic thinking in Japan about the Korean Peninsula is the weakest I've seen in 20 years. It's ironic because the Abe government is very strategic about the maritime domain, about values, about diplomacy. When it comes to the Korean Peninsula, Japan, the country where Yamagata Aritomo 100 some years ago famously said the Korean Peninsula is a dagger aimed at the heart of Antarctica, Japan has developed a bit of a blind spot strategically on the Korean Peninsula. A lot of this is because of the tensions between Tokyo and Seoul, the political tensions. A Yomiuri Shimbun poll in December indicated that well over 80% of Japanese say they don't trust Korea, which is by far the lowest number. And the problem with Japanese public opinion polling is, unlike Korean public opinion polling, which bounces all over, Japanese public opinion polling sticks. And so this is a bit worrisome. Genron NPO, a Japanese organization that does pretty effective popular polling, indicated that 74%, this just came out a couple weeks ago, 74% of Japanese think that Korea is to blame for the problems in Japan-Korea relations, another bad sign. And on the question of unification, the Genron NPO poll found, it's available in Japanese online, that only 12% of Japanese thought that a process of unification had begun, that unification was happening, that the jackpot speech was leading to a process of unification. 26% of Koreans said they thought the process of unification had begun. Polling on Japanese views of unification is hard to find. In 2007, I think it was Nikkei, but I may be wrong, I couldn't find it before today, did a poll asking the best way to solve the North Korea problem. They polled Americans, Japanese, and Koreans. Japanese overwhelmingly said the best way is regime change, which was third choice at the time for Koreans and second choice for Americans after diplomacy and pressure. But there hasn't been much polling since, in part because Japanese newspaper editors were criticized at the time and have avoided it. In general, I think the Japanese view is favorable to unification. Ambassador Muto, the Japanese ambassador in Seoul, has given speeches saying Japan would like to have a democratic, peaceful, stable neighbor that's open for business. That's all good for Japan. But there's anxiety about whether unified Korean Peninsula would become anti-Japanese. And there's a narrative in Tokyo, which I think is wrong, but is quite strong in academia and journalism and parts of government, that Korea is sliding into China's orbit. And so that creates some anxiety in Japan that was not there, say, 5-10 years ago. Russia, I think it will be hard for Russia to have a coherent Asia policy. It always has been, but particularly now given what's happened in Ukraine. Putin is obsessed with NATO and obsessed with the West. The consistent themes we've seen from Moscow, and I think we can continue to see, are Russia opposes nuclear weapons on the Korean Peninsula. Russia likes the six-party talks. And Russia would like to build a pipeline through North and South Korea to sell LNG to Japan and Korea. That third point, by the way, when I was in government, was usually the only one President Putin made in summits when the North Korea issue came up. But I think the dominant feature of Russian policy in Asia is going to be alignment with China because of the preoccupation with NATO and the West and the United States, and that we'll see Russia try to peel Japan and Korea off from the Western camp to try to break up pressure on them for Ukraine. At the end of the day, though, I think Russia will play a very important role in unification. As a repository state, Russia is able to accept fissile and nuclear material in the denuclearization process, and they have experience doing it with the United States. And that's an asset. The Russians are pretty experienced diplomatically in the six-party process. As a permanent member of the UN Security Council, will have an important role to play diplomatically. So Russia's a long-term investment, but in the near term, I think it's going to be difficult for Russia to play a positive role. The United States, last but hardly least, an Asia-Pacific power. As Sid said in his excellent presentation, the U.S. has been the most consistent supporter of unification of the Korean Peninsula outside of the Republic of Korea itself. The administration strongly supports President Park's policies on unification, as you heard. The expectations, I think, for any U.S. government would be that the Korean Peninsula, when unified, would be non-nuclear, democratic, although government officials tend not to say it because it's presumptuous, continuing the U.S. alliance. Non-nuclear means, in the near term, the very difficult job of preventing the leaking of nuclear material, weapons, chemical, biological, and engineers, or weapons officers who know how to use them. That's going to be a very, very tough near-term problem. A Korean Peninsula that's friendly with China and Japan is in U.S. interests. A Korean Peninsula that is, in the process of unification, not destabilizing the international economy, and therefore the IMF, World Bank, ADB, all the things that probably came up this morning would be important. And a process of unification that that is legitimate in the eyes of the world, and I have to say it, in the eyes of the Congress, in terms of transparency, denuclearization, property rights, rule of law, in the process of integrating North Korea into the ROK. At the end of the day, the U.S. has a big stake in successful democratic unification of the Korean Peninsula, not just to get rid of the North Korea problem, not just to turn Northeast Asia power relations in a positive direction, but to set an example, which Korea has done before. Korea's democratization in the 1980s, when I traveled to Indonesia or Myanmar, is the one that military officers who agreed to democratization point to. They don't point to the U.S., they don't point to Japan, they point to Korea, which successfully transitioned to democratic rule from military leadership and did so smoothly and created an enormous economic growth process along the way. That's pretty darn attractive to the TNI or to the current military in Myanmar. And I heard this in spades, as did Chris, when we were in Naypyidaw and Rangoon a year ago. So getting this right will have a powerful demonstration effect in the Cross Straits situation and elsewhere. Just as unification of Germany and the democratization process in Eastern Europe had a powerful effect on Korea and a powerful effect in Asia, this could be a very, very important demonstration effect. Korea has the toolkits to do this, to align the major powers behind a view of unification as a jackpot, not only economically, but for peace. I think the key tools will be the alliance with the United States, which is in good shape, I agree with Sid. The right balance of relations between Japan and China, which Korea does not have right now. High standards for human rights, democracy, denuclearization, strong leadership in international organizations, which Korea is demonstrating right now. And then Korea is going to have to fortify its own democracy, healing internal divisions, building consensus. And I would credit President Park for doing this. I think one of the most important aspects of her speeches on unification is she is building a middle ground in a very divisive Korean political environment where people can talk about unification and begin to have consensus within Korea, which will, at the end of the day, be the most important thing. Because Korea's coherent stability, vision, and determination on this will set how China, Russia, Japan, the U.S., and all the rest of us play our parts in this important process of unification. Thanks.
Mr. Park,
20 minutes?
Yes.
Okay. I am Ihn-Hwi Park, teaching. Is it working?
No.
I'm Ihn-Hwi Park, teaching at Iowa Women's University. You know, this is always exciting and honorable chance to share the possibility of peace on the Korean Peninsula, people from both countries, you know, Korea and the United States. Well, considering the subject of the panel, I mean the third session, I will mostly discuss about the connectiveness between interdependence between the Korean Peninsula and Northeast Asian region. Well, Every region, such as Northeast Asia, Middle East, Western Europe, they have a very unique political and economic and sometimes social unique connotation. So regarding, you know, the uniqueness of Northeastern region as an independent region who has a very unique security and economic and social and cultural background, what's the main difference between, you know, the regions such as Middle East or other regions and Northeast Asia? Well, people say that Northeast Asia as an independent region who has unique, you know, sense of the security connotation, that has a very critical reflection of the global powers, obviously such as US and China. And also Northeast Asian region, it has a very interesting coexistence between global scale competition, possibly between US and China, whether you agree or not, and also very unique regional level competition, such as, you know, Sino-Japan competition rivalry, or these days interesting rivalry and competition between Korea and Japan as well. And also, most importantly, regarding the main issue of today's conference, Northeast Asia has very unique, you know, security concern, which is North Korea's nuclear problem and, you know, still divided condition of the Korean Peninsula. The uniqueness of North Korean nuclear issue, as you all understand, there are five countries normally known as, you know, nuclear club recognized by NPT regime. And there are the three countries who never recognized by the NPT regime, such as Israel, Pakistan, India. But there is a very interesting difference, fundamental difference between North Korean case and those three countries of Pakistan, Israel, and India, which is, as you all understand, those three countries, they never joined to NPT regime. But as you know, North Korea is the only country, if we recognize North Korea as a nuclear state, the only and the first countries who, you know, the successfully conduct nuclear capability as a former member of the NPT regime. That means international recognition of the nuclear condition of North Korea, theoretically speaking, means, you know, the very fundamental undermining justification of the NPT regime. That is the major concern about North Korean problem in terms of Northeast Asian region, and also not only the Northeast Asian security concern, but also the whole global, you know, concern as well. Interestingly enough, this year, after 1994, Geneva Agreed Framework, which was the first diplomatic negotiation between U.S. and North Korea, and exactly we have two decades since, you know, the first negotiation conducted, if I remember correctly, October 21st in 1994. Ironically enough, for the past two decades, we have, you know, four regimes in South Korea, such as, interesting enough, two conservative regimes and two, relatively speaking, liberal regimes. That means we tried, not only South Korea, but also under the name of the international cooperation with the United States, we conducted a lot of policy towards North Korea, not only to achieve denuclearization, but also, you know, to achieve North Korean their economic reform or their change and their social openness, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, the trial and times was not that much successful. Within that condition, Park Geun-hye administration began, you know, the newly conducted last year, in terms of the security condition of Northeast Asian region, when Park Geun-hye administration began slightly before 1.5 years ago. As you remember, the year 2012 and 2013 was critically important, not only because of the, you know, regional and global dynamic, but also, interesting enough, all the six member countries under the name of the six-party talks, and even including the Mongol, they all changed new leadership, as you remember, you know, if we include Obama administration, beginning of the second term, we have a presidential election, end of the 2012, and also it was end of 2012, Abe administration began in Japan, and Xi Jinping, they began their very unique third, the fifth leadership in China sometime beginning of 2013. And even Putin, they began another term, the middle of the 2012, and et cetera. So not only South Korea, even theoretically speaking, also North Korea and Japan, China, they all tried to do something in terms of the, you know, changing the structural condition of Northeast Asia to maximize and to expand their national interest and their security interest. Well, and within that circumstance, North Korea, they conducted third nuclear test, which was February 13, 2013. Interesting enough, that was exactly 2 weeks before inauguration of the President Park Geun-hye. So people say that this is kind of interesting time and opportunity to begin kind of new approaches to handle North Korean problem and also to achieve fundamental security and economic prosperity in Northeast Asian region. Well, within that context, it is very interesting, you know, findings regarding, you know, the prosperity and security condition of Northeast Asian region, which is people say that one of the interesting opportunity to bring stability on within the region is to learn something from European countries, you know, simply speaking, kind of Northeast Asian version of Helsinki process, whatever you may call. Within, you know, based on that argument, it is very interesting findings again in Northeast Asia, which is if you include only three countries' GDP, I mean China, Japan, and Korea's GDP is almost 25% of the whole global GDP. Okay, so in terms of economic and social and cultural happenings, it is very interesting interdependence and very close, invisible integration between those three countries. But if you move to security and political condition, you know, such kind of invisible economic or social integration never easily transfer to positive outcomes or positive mutual respect between those countries. Theoretically speaking, as you know, people say that there's no spillover effect from, you know, social and economic condition and to political and security condition. Not only South Korean president, East Asian, Northeast Asian leaders, they have very interesting articulation or naming to describe such kind of wider gap between political area and economic area. For instance, President Park Geun-hye, she mentioned, according to her terminology, it is kind of Asia paradox, known as outside of Korea, to describe interesting and ironical gap between those two realities. As long as we have such kind of wider gap between political area and economic area, the establishment and permanent peace between the two Koreas and unification on the Korean Peninsula may be not that easily, you know, achievable. So again, you know, the in terms of the, you know, the connectiveness and linkage between Korean Peninsula and Northeast Asian region, one of the critical approach or solution to figure out the permanent stability and the economic prosperity in Northeast Asian region is to achieve unification on the Korean Peninsula. Well, interestingly enough, you know, the divided condition on the Korean Peninsula, some kinds of could be arguable issue, but divided condition of the Korean Peninsula is kind of the outcomes or consequence of the international politics in one sense. So that means to achieve peace and unification on the Korean Peninsula also should be something conducted from, you know, international circumstance and international cooperation. If you think about the beginning of the modern international relations in Northeast Asia, I would say that someone may have different viewpoint, but I would say that beginning of the modern international relations only after World War II. You know, every country, each member state may have different background, but modern sense of the sovereignty, modern sense of nation state shared, broadly shared only after World War II. That means unified Korea, you know, Northeast Asian having unified Korea never experienced in the time of the modern international relations in East Asia, in Northeast Asia. Again, that means to fundamentally handle the structural problem, wider gap between security condition and economic reality may be achieved by the unification on the Korean Peninsula. by saying unification jackpot, whatever, by saying unification breakthrough, you know, specifically means in terms of the political sense, such kind of expansion and positive interdependence between peace on the Korean Peninsula and peace and stability in Northeast Asian region. Well, to achieve that goals and to achieve such kind of future process, we have also, you know, a couple of the concerns and problems as well. One of the critical concern is, you know, we as mentioned, positively mentioned, the special envoy, Mr. Seiler, during the luncheon session, but still all the discussions that we had in the morning session under the name of the economic benefit, you know, the economic, the rosy outcome, future outcomes after the unification, those are all kind of third or second or even fifth or, you know, the fourth buttons. We just assume that the first button will be easily handled, which is denuclearization of North Korea and which is the possibility of regime change or whatever in North Korea. So the unification should include, you know, more specific condition and more specific policy suggestions that, you know, that may bring the positive process of North Korea's denuclearization. Again, also in terms of the concern to achieve Korea's unification within the context of Northeast Asian region, I also think about how to visualize the neighboring state benefit from the unification of the Korean Peninsula. That means theoretically, we whenever we have a chance, we say that unification could be beneficial not only to the two Koreas, but also, you know, US, China, Japan, and even Russia. But it is still a very tough question how to visualize or specifically, you know, show the specific future benefit of the unification to those neighboring countries, not only in terms of the theoretical, you know, terrain, but also in terms of the specific benefit going to those countries, those member countries. Park Geun-hye administration to expand, okay, again, to expand such kind of, you know, the peace on the level of the Korean Peninsula to Northeast Asian region. For instance, Park Geun-hye administration, they, you know, whenever they have a chance, they articulate Northeast Asian Peace and Cooperation Initiative. But again, it is very, you know, persuasive and meaningful suggestion, but at the same time, we, not only Park Geun-hye administration, but previous Korean, South Korean administrations such as Kim Dae-jung and etc., they suggested many regional policies to bring peace on the Korean Peninsula, such as New Asian policy, or even, I personally understand, during the Nomuen administration, balancing between US and China is also, you know, kind of the South Koreans' trial to do something to achieve positive outcomes in the region. Well, whenever I have a chance to discuss between the connectiveness Korea and Northeast Asian region, I say that as all the human beings does, the state, individual country, I believe they have a unique identity or DNA as well. For theoretical term or for policy, you know, the connotation, we quite often mention the names such as Northeast Asia, but I don't think no one other than Korea can be identified as a Northeast Asian state. I don't believe, obviously, US, I don't believe China or Japan, they try to describe themselves as Northeast Asian state. If we have choose only one state in the world who is under the name of the Northeast Asian state, I would say that that is Korea. That means, again, regional stability and prosperity of Northeast Asian region is the most critical condition to, you know, to guarantee or maximize South Korea's, the future Korea's national interest. Finally, I would say that if you think about the end of the World War II, how many countries divided? People say five, including Germany, Korea, China, Vietnam, and Yemen. But Yemen can be categorized within different, you know, the meanings and significance. So, you know, countries were divided after World War II, such as Germany, China, Vietnam, and Korea. After the unification of the Vietnam, South Korea, we did our best to avoid Vietnam way of the unification. After the German unification, as you easily assume, North Korea, they are doing their best to avoid German way of the unification. And no one say, no one, you know, it is kind of international general recognition to understand one China policy. That means no one identify the China and Taiwan condition in terms of the competition reliability. We just assume, you know, recognize mainland China on the name of the one China policy. So that means we are, you know, doing a lot to figure out, to take some lessons from German unification, obviously. But if you take a look at, you know, the process of German unification, not only the between the two German, you know, integration or the process, but also European diplomatic condition and global diplomatic circumstance was very critical factor to bring the permanent unification in case of Germany. That means Korean unification, which is obviously positive to neighboring countries and to global society as well, but you have to visualize that. And again, because of the unique interdependence between Korean case and Northeast Asian region, you know, international cooperation and efficient, you know, diplomatic assistance between U.S. and Korea, definitely meaningful factor and foundation to achieve unification of the Korean Peninsula. Thank you very much.
There are two discussants, starting with Chris Johnson. Thanks.
Thank you. And Victor, thank you for inviting me to participate on this panel. It's a very interesting topic. In the interest of time, I think I'm going to truncate my remarks a little bit so we can get on to Bruce and get on to some discussion. Let me just raise a couple of points. First, I'd like to just sort of echo in Mike's presentation the emphasis on stability, obviously, for China as they look at reunification and unification of the peninsula. Under what terms that would take place, China's core principles really haven't changed on that front. They do want it, as Mike said, to sort of be independent. They want the North Koreans to have a heavy say, and obviously the thing they want the least is U.S. troops right on their border. That's really been the long-time concern. There's been a lot of debate since Xi Jinping, the new Chinese president, took over power in the fall of 2012 about whether or not China's North Korea policy has been changing, and therefore its general approach to the peninsula writ large. Kind of the key indicators that people often cite on that is the reordering of the phraseology, if you will, for the Chinese in terms of its priorities on the peninsula, moving denuclearization to the front rather than its former position in the third of three. Some discussion about whether or not there's a more robust debate now inside China with regard to the role North Korea plays for China as a buffer state, and in fact whether or not that continues to be the case. That debate was really quite strong early on in Xi Jinping's tenure, with some sides arguing it doesn't really matter what type of regime we have there as long as there's something physical there that serves as this buffer, and others arguing that that may have been true in the past, but increasingly provocative North Korean behavior may be making that less true and damaging our position in the wider region. It's my sense that this debate has largely quieted, if not completely gone away. And I don't think that's because one side or the other necessarily won. I just think they moved on to other subjects. And this really is the core issue, is to think about a lot of this ink and commentary and other things that have been spilled on whether or not China has changed its policy. To me, that's not really the point. And you can argue the merits and difficulties of that point as much as you want. I think the key factor is to look at how Xi Jinping has changed the relationship with the North Koreans, and it's really this idea of moving the relationship from the traditional special relationship between China and North Korea to a normal bilateral relationship. And I think this is a very strong theme that we've seen under Xi Jinping's leadership, and there's several things to me that indicate that this is in fact going on. The first is, of course, the lack of high-level visits, symmetry between the Chinese and the North Koreans. Kim Jong-un has yet to visit Beijing. Xi Jinping has no inclination to go to North Korea at this particular time. There are still high-level dialogues at the sort of next tier down between the two sides, but there's been no major symmetry. Not only that, but Xi Jinping has turned much more towards South Korea in his diplomacy, and seems to have a very solid working relationship with President Park, a very successful summit here recently. And some of this is driven by this idea that some in China perceive that there is an opportunity, given the close economic interdependence, growing the interdependence between China and the Republic of Korea's economies, that there's an opportunity, for lack of a better term, to peel South Korea off from the United States, as Mike had mentioned in his remarks. I agree with Mike that I think that's ridiculous, especially when you look at the way the summit unfolded between President Park and Xi Jinping. While there was a lot of positive to the summit, there was also some behavior by the Chinese with regard to how the summit was arranged and the things Xi Jinping said in various speeches and so on that clearly ruffled the South Koreans' feathers. So I think those in Beijing who seem to think that this is working or there's a huge opportunity here should be more cautious. I think the other thing that we see that sort of emphasizes this issue of special to normal is their whole approach in the region. And this is where we come to Xi Jinping's sort of thoughts about a new style of major country relations with the United States, but that only the United States merits a new style of major country relations. For all the other regional players and everyone else, it's more this sort of great power diplomacy approach that is emerging. So gone is the sort of rhetoric of Deng Xiaoping, of biding their time and keeping a low profile internationally. And instead, we see much more of a philosophy where the idea is China is already a great power, a rising great power, but has already arrived at that status and should act like a traditional great power in its foreign relations. And this has a real impact on its approach to the Korean Peninsula. I think with North Korea, the message we see from the new Chinese leadership is basically, we are the big brother in the partnership, you are the little brother, your behaviors should not be such that cause us problems as the larger party, and we're not going to make special sort of arrangements for the traditional special relationship, such as making sure every time we have a visit with the South Koreans, there's a parallel visit with the North Korean side and so on. And in fact, it appears to me that relations between the two leaders in particular, well, they're basically non-existent between Xi and Kim Jong-un, and I don't see them radically improving in the near future. Likewise, we see the similar approach with South Korea, where the economic interests, the other interests that China's have on the peninsula right now lean in that direction. So we see him emphasizing that relationship, and I think this is going to continue going into the future. So what does this mean for how the Chinese might be thinking about unification? I very much agree with Mike that the sort of idea of delayed unification is in their interest. They don't want to see this happen anytime soon. Certainly, they believe that time is on their side in both pieces of the relationship, especially, I think, with South Korea, where they do believe that over time, the economics and other factors will allow them to have stronger sway with the South Koreans. And the sense as well that this way they'll have a better sort of set of eyes and ears, if you will, by re-emphasizing the relationship with South Korea, getting a better feel on both sides of the peninsula for how they're approaching the Korean Peninsula issues and the potential for unification. I do think over time that the Chinese don't reflexively deny the interest in or opportunity for reunification. But for now, the debate about whether or not that can happen and under what terms has largely been shelved. And I think that's the other thing to stress, just in closing with China's approach, is that it's my opinion that Xi Jinping actually is not paying a lot of attention to North Korea policy or to Korean policy writ large, other than this warming to South Korea. He set out the tenets of their approach, and he's kind of letting it hold for now while he works on issues with Russia, relationship with the United States, and so on. So whereas under Hu Jintao, the issue was a little more on the front lines, and a lot of that was due to North Korea's behavior, I think with the Xi Jinping administration, we're seeing obviously the need to continue to manage a relationship very carefully, strong concern about what happens on the peninsula, but it's not going to be a strong driver for their diplomacy going forward. Likewise, I think the fundamental reason for why we've been able to see this change is because of Xi Jinping's rapid consolidation of power and the fact that he is running Chinese foreign policy pretty much unilaterally. The formal mechanisms of Chinese diplomacy are not operating as much as they were under the previous leadership. Foreign ministry has very little say on these policies. Even the party's international liaison department, which was very influential in shaping the relationship with North Korea under the previous administration, doesn't have a whole lot to do with it at this stage, or certainly not the independent influence that they had before. We see this in the fact that the Chinese Foreign Ministry has begun taking more of a role in managing at least the mechanics of bilateral visits and so on with the China-North Korea relationship, and that the ILD's influence really has been sort of downgraded, and I expect that to continue. Likewise, there's no one on the Standing Committee, as there was in the previous Politburo Standing Committee leadership, who really has a say on North Korean policy. Zhou Yongkang, now famously in trouble with this corruption investigation, had been educated in North Korea, and even though he was number 9 of 9 on the former Politburo Standing Committee, he had undue influence on shaping North Korea policy. And you had several members of that Standing Committee who, frankly, were very conservative on North Korea policy and wanted to see very little change. That's not the case in the new Politburo Standing Committee, and Xi is certainly calling the tune on that, and I expect them to continue doing so going forward. I'll stop there. Thanks.
Great. Thanks, Chris. Very much. And then Bruce. Thanks, Bruce.
Oh, thank you very much. Victor referred to me as the cleanup batter, which sort of gives the image of my predecessors would simply try to get on base, and I would bring them all home with a mighty cloud of my analytic bat. I think it's more a case of each of them has not only hit home runs, they've hit the ball out of the park, and now the crowd sort of collectively looks at me and says, okay, laughing boy, let's see what you got. I think when we talk about unification, we have to be clear. It really is absorption of the North by the South. And indeed, the Article 4 of the South Korean Constitution calls upon the Republic of Korea to formulate and carry out a policy of peaceful unification based on the principles of freedom and democracy, neither of which exist in North Korea. So this is not a case of trying to average out two systems. Indeed, you can't. For example, on human rights, if North Korea is a 0 and South Korea is a 10, you can't have as your quest to get a 5. You're not just going to keep some of the gulags in order to end up with a 5 in human rights. And similarly, you can't equate or average a command economy and free market principles. So really, South Korea shouldn't really be striving to average these two countries out, but it really is indeed, having the South Korean system of freedom and democracy, free market principles, and respect for law and human rights prevail. There's nothing to save in the North Korean system. So, and North Korea knows this, and that's why they are so resistant to the Dresden Declaration of President Park, or really opening up their economy or their political system to what they see as the contagion of outside influence. So I think really there would be perhaps three scenarios for unification. The first is the Blue House gets a phone call from Pyongyang. They say, we've been talking it over amongst ourselves, and you guys win. We'll leave the lights on. Well, they can't leave the lights on because they have no electricity, but you guys win, it's yours. We're all heading across the border into China. That's not going to happen. The second one is a gradual reconciliation, a gradual reform, a gradual meeting in the middle between the Koreas, and that's not going to happen because Kim Jong-un, like his predecessors, have made very, very clear that they have no interest in making any kind of political or economic reform. They've made that clear in their New Year's Day speeches and their Central Committee comments. They even became so frustrated with speculation of impending reform under Kim Jong-un that they issued statements of sort of foolish politicians of the world, particularly in the South, should not expect us to change one iota from Kim Jong-ilism and Kim Il-sungism. So we know that they're not going to change. Now, as we look around the area, as our speakers have done, is at some of the other players, with China, I agree that China has not changed its policy. And certainly China, even though it said it accepts Korean unification, I think there's a very big asterisk as to what conditions they would accepted upon. When Xi Jinping was in Seoul and spoke at Seoul National University, you know, he made a great declaration of how Korea and China share interests, and he cited the Imjin War. You know, I might have said, sir, there's a more recent war where China fought against South Korea. And also, when, you know, as some Koreans will blame the United States for dividing the peninsula, but the UNC forces, the Allied forces, were on the cusp of uniting the Korean Peninsula when China was the one that prevented that. So I think that's something to keep in mind when Beijing has its latest charm offensive towards Seoul. And certainly it doesn't have South Korea's best interests in their heart when they push against South Korea better defending its population against the North Korean missile threat, trying to pressure South Korea against adopting better ballistic missile defense, et cetera. The other great players, the U.S., and I think it's important to include us even when we just talk about Northeast Asian perspectives. I think we're very, very much involved. People have asked over time, what is the U.S. policy on unification? And I think U.S. diplomats, and we have several in here, will sort of be frustrated and say the U.S. policy has always been protecting Korea as it works towards a peaceful unification. And as the father of a teenage daughter, I sort of think it's fine for the Koreas to talk, it's fine for the Koreas to date. Our role is sort of the protective father walking 10 steps behind with a shotgun, making sure Korea is not taken advantage of. So Korea should be in the driver's seat. It's a matter for the Korean people. We just are there to make sure that South Korean interests are protected. And when people ask what would be the role of U.S. forces Korea after unification, really, I think it's too early to say. It would depend on the timing. It would depend on the circumstances of when that happens. Perhaps both the U.S. and South Korea would see no more need for the U.S. forces Korea, and then we would come home. Or there may be growing concern, as there is now, about Chinese intentions or other things. So, you know, I think that's an issue we can, you know, sort of skip over for now. There's also been a lot of talk today about the jackpot. And I think really that was an appeal by President Park to the South Korean populace. There's been declining support domestically for Korean unification, particularly amongst the youth. And I saw recent polls that for, I think in the first time in my memory, a majority of South Koreans did not support unification. The number, I believe, was 49% in support of unification. And I believe that's the first time I've seen it dip below 50%. So I think really, particularly the younger generation, sees the negative economic impact that unification would have on their economy and the national economy. And so I think, in a way, President Park's appeal that unification would not be a drain on the economy but would be a jackpot really was a way of trying to reverse this downward trend in South Korean public support for unification. I think we can all be hopeful for unification. I don't see it happening anytime soon. I'm reminded in 2000, the year 2000, when after the first inter-Korean summit and the sort of the very emotional joint North-South Korean walking into the Sydney Olympics, a very senior CIA official was chastising those of us who worked the Korea issue that we were missing it, that the Koreas were on the cusp of unification, that just like the Soviet analysts had missed the collapse of the Soviet Union, like the German analysts had missed the rapid unification of Germany, that we were getting it wrong and that we really had to understand that Korea was on the cusp of unification. Well, he was wrong, although he got highly promoted. It's, as we pointed out at the time, that if this was like the Germanies, it wasn't the Germanies right after the fall of the Berlin Wall. It was more like the Germanies in 1970 when there started to be engagement. So I think we can hope for unification. Certainly we should be prepared for it. But I think, I don't see it happening anytime soon. And I think really, as Michael pointed out, unification is going to happen with the collapse. Not that anyone wants to induce collapse because we're afraid of what could happen. I think it's as if we're all on one side of a swamp. We're in a stable environment. On the other side of the swamp, we see the quest. We see a peaceful unification of the Korean people. The problem is between here and there is a very messy, potentially dangerous swamp. And no one wants to jump into that swamp in order to get to the other side. So right now, it tends to be sort of a passive, you know, the devil you know rather than the devil you don't know. But that's not to say we can't still be preparing for it and certainly still hoping for it. So, kamsahamnida.
Thank you, Bruce. I want to thank all of our panelists in particular for staying within their time constraints, because we actually have some time for a question and discussion. So I'm going to open the floor in a minute, but before I do, I want to put one question in the queue for our two presenters, and that is that in the morning session, when we talked about some of the economic and business and investment synergies, the term peace dividend came up a number of times. And obviously no one can quantify that, but they deferred to the panelists in the afternoon to try to explain what a peace dividend would look like. So I would ask our two presenters to think about that, and specifically how they would imagine a peace dividend from unification. Now I'd like to open it to the floor for questions. Yes? Can we get a mic over here? And please identify yourself and please ask a question.
Hi, Chen Weihua, China Daily. Chris, you talked about Xi's new policy from special to normal. So has President Park, or maybe Mr. Park here also, you know, you're advising the Ministry of Unification. So has President Park returned with the message that you know, a reunified Korea will not be, you know, a U.S. military base, which means the U.S. troops will not move from DMZ to the Yalu River? And second, you know, is, you know, a lot of people talk about the reunification's impact on China's probably cross-strait relations, as Mike mentioned. But according to the panel's discussion this morning, the conditions of exchange of economic activities, people's exchange, that seems to be more mature on the Chinese mainland, the Taiwan side. So could Chinese reunification actually happen earlier? Thank you.
That's directed to you, Chris, yeah. Specifically. Why don't you take that one?
Okay, I'm happy to answer the second question. I think you guys might be more qualified to answer the first question. On whether or not China-Taiwan reunification could happen more quickly, I think, as Mike was suggesting in his comments, certainly if there was Korean Peninsula reunification, and as Bruce suggested, it was done in the direction coming from the south, this would be an issue. I think more importantly, the more pressing issue may be what we've been seeing in Hong Kong policy in the last week or two, where folks sitting in Taipei are certainly having a hard time understanding one country, two systems, and the benefits of that, given what's happening in Hong Kong. So I think we have to watch and see what happens over the course of cross-strait relations in the coming months. You know, if we have a situation where in the upcoming local elections in Taiwan, the Democratic Progressive Party is seen as doing particularly well and so on, then the trend line may be, in fact, toward another period of more difficulty in the cross-strait relationship. Certainly, if, as I said, there was some sort of massive movement on the Korean Peninsula, this would then put some pressure, I suppose you could say, on the two sides, as they would then be the one remaining World War II unresolved issue. As far as Madam Park's assurances to President Xi, I don't have a sense for that. Maybe others do.
Well, I don't know, and Professor Kim might. I very much doubt that President Park would say to
me too
Xi Jinping that there would be no U.S. bases north of the DMZ or anything specific at all about U.S. forward military posture on the Korean Peninsula after unification for a whole host of reasons. One is there's no guarantee the U.S. Congress will want U.S. forces on the Korean Peninsula. Yeah. It depends on what the security environment is. What are the threats? is the Korean Peninsula going to face a security threat from China or not? And if it is, what kind of alliance and what kind of posture would be best for Korea's interests and tolerable for the U.S.? And so, as Bruce said earlier, I think that an alliance without some military presence is just not as credible or useful to the Republic of Korea. We have an alliance without bases with Australia, but I think that's a unique exception. Because Korea would rely on the U.S. extended nuclear deterrent and the credibility of deterrence, where it really is in a critical situation, means you have to have boots on the ground. You've got to have some, physical demonstration. Some people call it a tripwire. My friends in the 2nd Infantry Division call themselves a speed bump. Whatever it is, I think there would be some kind of presence. Militarily, I don't think the U.S., who knows who will be running the Pentagon at the time, but I don't think the U.S. will want troops on the Yalu River. Politically and operationally, it doesn't make sense, but I think there could be some presence. But what that would be, nobody could say. And so it would be foolish to put that as a chip for that reason, and it also would be foolish because it would suggest that the ROK will not determine its own security requirements. And I think it's very important for President Park or any Korean leader to make it very clear that the ROK is going to determine what it needs for its security, and including alliance with the U.S., including multilateral, whatever approaches it is, and it would be, she wouldn't get much for it, and it would send the wrong signals, and you couldn't really say one way or the other what the presence would be. Now, I don't know what actually happened, so Professor, you may know the inside story.
Well, as you mentioned, the future, the possible changing nature of the Korea-U.S. alliance quite depends on what kind of security circumstance. When we have the process of unification, obviously, but at the same time, we need to think about that. Theoretically speaking, the alliance partnership, from the Korean side, U.S. is the only alliance partner. At the same time, but from the U.S. side, I'm not sure how many alliance partners, more than 30 or 40, I assume about that number. But in terms of the North Korea and the China relations, from Chinese side, North Korea is the only country who described as alliance partner. At the same time, from North Korean side, China is only one country who is on the name of the alliance partnership. So it's a very complicated situation, all the alliance partnerships. But again, quite depends on the, what kind of security circumstances around the Korean Peninsula is pending on the process of the unification.
On this peace dividend question, I'm a little more skeptical that there's going to be a big peace dividend. We don't know. But I'm not sure that we can predict it for a couple, if I could.
Yeah, please.
One reason is a significant part of Korea's defense is now handled by the United States. And after unification, I think the pressure from the U.S. Congress would be, as it has been for decades, for Korea to take much more of a role in its own defense. So there are going to be some requirements in terms of intelligence and ISR and so forth that we've been trying to get the Korean government to pay for, that they would be more likely to have to pay for. Why? Because the PLA defense buildup, the military budget has been increasing for over a decade at double-digit numbers. Japan, although I don't think Japan's a threat to Korea, has a pretty considerable defense force, and Russia. And so there's still going to be an environment of uncertainty that's going to require an investment in defense and new capabilities. I would like to see it in alliance with the U.S. and embedded in a multilateral process that builds confidence, but I don't think that any Korean president's going to say, because the North Korean threat is gone, we don't have to worry about these other large militaries in this region. Now, there will be defense cuts, and I suspect the draft may go away and things like that, but there will be other requirements that will have to be filled. So is the peace dividend 20 or 30%, maybe? Is it 50%? I doubt it.
Okay. Bruce?
Yeah, I would just say, the disposition of U.S. forces on or near the Korean Peninsula is a matter for Washington and Seoul, thank you very much, and it'll be determined by the best national interests of the U.S. and its ally. In the meantime, we might seek reassurance from Beijing that they will not seek to impede the reunification of the Korean people, and also seek greater transparency as to what Beijing's intent is in fulfilling its military alliance with North Korea and wonder at what conditions it would do so, and greater transparency as to what it might do during unification or collapse scenarios, which so far it has been very reticent to do so. While we're at it, we might look for greater transparency on Chinese military policy and intentions in Northeast Asia. And then on the peace dividend, I remember after the collapse of the Soviet Union, when people said, what are we going to spend the peace dividend on? It was sort of 50% for greater infrastructure, 50% for reduced taxes, 50% for greater welfare spending, 50%, you know, so it sort of very quickly goes away.
Great. Yes, Mike.
Michael Marshall, Global Peace Foundation. Michael Green said in his presentation, spoke about certain circles in Japan who are very concerned about the growing closeness of relationship between Korea and China, and thought that basically Korea was being seduced by China. I have Japanese colleagues who very much share that view. You said you disagree with that. I wonder if you could give us the reasons why you disagree with that view.
I think that the Japanese observers of the Republic of Korea's current foreign policy strategy do not fully appreciate how strong the U.S.-Korea alliance is. And so they're looking at everything, this is a bit of an exaggeration, but largely through the problem of China and Asia. And they're seeing that Japan has 96% popularity in Southeast Asia. Modi of India just had a, you know, Taibok, you know, jackpot summit with Abe. He has the best relations with Putin of any of the democracies. But Korea, it seems, is playing to China's game to isolate Japan, seems to be the only one. But what they don't see is the depth of support in Korea and in the U.S. for our bilateral alliance, the strength of our common values, our ability to manage provocations, to deal with wartime, off-contrast issues, all these very hard alliance issues, which in the U.S.-Japan alliance might freeze everybody. We just tilt. But the U.S. and Korea have managed them very well. And I think our Japanese friends don't always see that. And the mirror is true. I don't think our Korean friends appreciate how much the U.S.-Japan alliance is critical to the U.S. and how what Abe is doing, not on the history side or ideologically, but in terms of these, from a U.S. perspective, quite modest defense reforms are long overdue and are good for the security of Korea. And so the two, the politics don't blind both sides, both Tokyo and Seoul, to the fundamental strength and necessity of the U.S. alliance with each or with the other. But it is a powerful narrative, and I think it's changing. I think it's slowly beginning to change. And I'm hopeful that we'll have a reasonably good Park Abe summit when these APEC and EAS meetings happen in November. Fingers crossed.
Please, Park. Regarding the debt question, you know, not only from the Japanese side, you know, because of the increasing cooperation between Korea and China, someone may have I'm not sure how many of you, but someone may have some negative understanding. But I do clearly say that if you have the same voice inside of the U.S., I would say that I don't think the closeness between Korea and China definitely replaced Korea-U.S. alliance. I mean, obviously, we share a lot of meaningful values and democracy and freedom and market principle as well. If you think about the last year, 60s, U.S.-Korea alliance, you know, we agreed a new statement. Within that statement, we agreed and we showed that very, you know, the meaningful, positive mission and functional, you know, the goals as well. But comparing the neighborhood countries such as U.S., China, and Japan, South Korea, we have very limited policy options and relatively speaking, limited, you know, diplomatic asset. Because of such kind of condition, sometimes you may interpret, you know, we are a little bit aggressing, you know, jumping to China side. But again, we are not replacing something or comparing something just under the name of the Korea's national interest, but under the principle of the, you know, values and fundamental, you know, ideas and human rights, et cetera, obviously.
Thank you. Yes.
Listening to the panels this morning and now, seems to be a couple of conclusions can be drawn. Some said, some not said. Some not said is if Korea wants to be united and we want it to be free and free enterprise, democratic, human rights, if Korea ever is going to move that way, there's no other country except South Korea that must take the initiative. Would the panel agree with that view? Nobody else will take the initiative to bring Korean Peninsula to the kind of country, one Korea, that we talk about. The second thing that emerges kind of as a commonality that's been said many times is cost and benefits. Everyone agrees that seems to be the benefits are very great and it's perpetual. And cost is a very heavy, but it's short term. But in terms of time, the cost is a lot heavier first, and it will take 12, 15 years, and then stock markets emerge and so on. The bonanza may or may not happen. It's the time in the middle that I want to ask some questions about the panel. The Japan, China, Russia all has very heavily nuanced attitude towards Korea's unification issue. And their position is now with the current situation of divided Korea, with all the histories culminating to this point. Now, let's say we are at about half point into that. Somebody characterized, we have two scenarios, very perpetual, you know, consensual approach, and then abrupt and drastic decline, collapse of North Korean regime. But in all reality, it'll be some combination of the two. It'll be perpetual dialogue, consensual way, and at some point, I think it'll be coming down to some drastic. By the standards of today's view, it's not so drastic. It may be a little bit less shocking than what can be anticipated from the collapse of the regime now. But let's say there is some movement, there is some peace direction, and 5-6 years passed, and somehow idea emerges. Unification is an irreversible, invincible direction. It's the way to go. It's set, and there's no way to turn around. If Korean situation somehow reached that point, what then would the attitude of Japan, China, and Russia would be? What I see in the panel is all experts. You have a China chair, Korea chair, and Japan chair. So I cannot see where else I can go to get a better opinion. So at that point, some 5, 6, 7 years from now, suppose that ideally an idea is established, Korea is going to be united. There's a lot of problems, a lot of hassle, chaos, but that's the history. Okay. That's the stream. It's going. At that point, what okay, let's get the an answer. Attitude of the
let's
countries
get an answer from our panelists. Let's get an answer from our, so, Dr. Park?
Well, yes, obviously, you know, it's our problem, okay? It's our, you know, under the our mission, and, you know, South Korea is supposed to have full degree of the authority in terms of how to achieve the, you know, unification. But again, as I briefly mentioned in the presentation, you know, if you think about the divided condition, the beginning of the divided condition, and the process and development of the divided condition, obviously, international cooperation and international circumstances is one of the critical factors to achieve peace and prosperity in the Korean Peninsula. So I'm not missing, you know, I'm not saying that you know, international players is more important than Korea, you know, the independent authority, but I'm just saying that you know, international factor is very critical, the identity and nature of Northeast Asian region. And at the same time, in the middle of the, in the center of the Northeast Asian region, South Korea's problem is existing. That's, you know, just what I'm saying.
I like Bruce's 1 to 10, you know, thing, because you can't get unification by having 5. I thought that was a good way to put it. Another way to think about it is, what keeps the Kim Il-sung, Kim Jong-il, Kim Jong-un dynasty in power? Unparalleled coercive tools, Yodok, the gulags, criminal syndicates, nuclear weapons, largest biological chemical arsenals in the world, and the premise that North Korea is legitimate and South Korea doesn't have a right to exist. So how does it maintain those four instruments of rule when we get to the point you're talking about, where unification is now inevitable? Because none of those will be acceptable to the international community.
and to change any one of them is potentially suicidal for the regime. So that's why I'm with Bruce. I think it's possible, as you say, there could be a sort of process of dialogue, but I think at some point the North rapidly loses control, or it plays that game to see what it can get and stops the process. On the big powers and unification, I mean, I think I ended with this, but the tragic geostrategic history of the Korean Peninsula is that when Korea is divided, the big powers are drawn in. And historically, when Korea is divided, different camps invite in big powers into their internal struggle. And that's the source of much of that and geography, and they're related, is the source of much of the tragedy of the Korean Peninsula. So if the big powers think there's not a consensus within the South, or that there's a wobbliness, they will be tempted to come in and try to dominate the process at the expense of the other big powers. And so that's why, as I said, I think Park Geun-hye, although Bruce is right, she did this because I think of the polls about unification, but what she's potentially done is created a basis for discussing unification that will narrow the gaps within Korean politics and society, because it's so important that in this process, the Republic of Korea demonstrate its willpower to unify and its principles and conviction, and what is not up for negotiation, which would be democracy, I would think alliance with the U.S., or at least a democratic system aligned with Western values and international organizations, and demonstrating a consensus behind that is critical. Park Geun-hye cannot say what Bruce and I are saying, although I suspect she thinks it, because that would break that safe middle ground to talk about unification in a way that builds consensus. And so I don't blame her for that. I think she's doing the right thing. But I think for those of us who are planning what this will look like, we should be expecting not a five, but a whatever the one. Enough, you know, all gone in the North.
Yeah, maybe I'm just wordsmithing, but when you said South Korea should take the unification initiative, I mean, you can take an initiative and you may want to, it sort of implies taking the initiative today. Well, you can do that by eloping and going down a path of federation and confederation where I don't think it's in Seoul's self-interest. I might wordsmith and say, I think South Korea should be in the driver's seat once conditions are ripe for unification. But it's right now, maybe being in the driver's seat means the engine is idling and that there's not necessarily a push to move forward. But I think when the conditions are ripe for unification, I think South Korea should be the one in the driver's seat. And I guess at that point, taking the initiative.
Great, that's a great place on which to end this panel. I want you to thank our panelists very much for an interesting discussion. We'll now take a break. I think there's coffee set up outside for you, and then we'll reconvene in 15 minutes for the last panel.